So the issue of the Garo Hills Autonomous District Council, sir. Now this has been an issue also that a lot of people have been talking about and concerned about. And I would like to just, for the record, stress on really what the situation in Garo Hills District Council is, sir. Now, there have been a lot of talks among the members about the fact that many months of salaries are pending in the Garo Hills Autonomous District Council. So let me just give you a background on what really is happening in Garo Hills Autonomous District Council. So Garo Hills Autonomous District Council has a rough monthly revenue of 1.2 crores. 1.2 crores of monthly revenue. Whereas the expenditure on salary alone, forget the other expenditures, is 4 crores plus. So salaries is 4 crores and the revenue is 1.2 crores. Now, why is the salary so high? Let me just go into a bit of the background, sir. So just for the knowledge of all the members in the House, sir, in 2012, the staff strength of the district council was approximately 1,300 employees. So in 2011, the staff strength was 1,400, approximately, sir. In the year 2013 to 2015, there were appointments of 720 employees that was done by the then EC that was led by the CEM of the Congress Party, sir. And during that time, the number of employees went up from 1,400 to over 2,100, sir. And the salary component, which used to be 1.8 crores, jumped to 3.8 crores, 2 crores additional amount was spent because of this appointment of 720 employees, which was done arbitrarily, with no logic, with no procedure, and not even the pay scale was uniform. Somebody was getting 5,000, somebody was getting 15,000, somebody was getting 30,000. I don't know, sir, what kind of system was followed. And because of this appointment of 720 people in the year 2013 to 15, under the Congress government that time in the district council, the council today, till today, is suffering. Till today, sir, it went up from 1.8 crores to 3.8 crores today. And let me tell you, when the NPP-led government took over, Mr. Dipul took over the regime out there, detailed work went into the payroll. The government then started computerizing the entire employees list. Roll calls were made. They started checking whether these employees are there or not. And let me inform you, sir, that the number of employees which was increased from 1,400 to 2,300 went down to 1,670, almost 700 employees again were removed because they were ghost employees. Some of them were not even in the payroll. And today, 700 less numbers are there. And this kind of computerization process today has helped us to reduce the overall burden of salaries that has been there. So one has to realize, again, sir, the reason I need to mention this, again, I appreciate when Honorable Member from Surangsa Kona says that we don't need to play blame games. We are not, sir. It is only, it starts somewhere, and then obviously we have to react to it, because otherwise, you know, public will think that what they are saying is correct. So obviously we have to react, we have to respond. I don't wish to blame anybody, but then don't blame us either. Let's take the responsibility together. So when you are irresponsible and then tell us that act responsibly, I think that's not correct. So therefore, this is the kind of situation that was faced during that time. And so if you remember, it was in 2013 and 15 when the coal ban also took place. So keeping in mind that the revenue is going to drop, the appointment of additional employees should never have happened during that time in the council. And that's really sad, sir. But, sir, we are now in the process of reforming things. Reformation has started. Now every employee has to be accounted in the payroll. Money is given through the accounts. It's no longer cash payments. We have started computerizing the tax also, which is going to become online. The treasury is becoming online. Computerization and automation of salary, which is the payroll, is taking place. All these improvements are now making a difference. There was a time where Garhwa's district council did not even have a procurement policy. So the question is how the auctioning will take place or how the tenders will take place, whether there'll be a Swiss challenge model. No policy was in place. It is now that we've started putting these policies in place. Now there's a procurement policy, and slowly we'll put up other systems also to ensure that we start to streamline the district council slowly and steadily, sir. So I'm hopeful that in the coming months and years and in the future, if the work continues, then we will be able to transform the work in district council. But there still remains an inherent problem, which is the huge amount of dues that are there, and number two, a large number of employees, and number three, very less scope of revenue generation, which all these aspects need to be looked into and worked. And I think it's important that we all, whether it's opposition or ruling, we all need to be concerned about this, because district councils are important for us. They're an important institution, a constitutional body. They're a body that is independent. And that's why when, you know, comments come that why isn't the government giving money? So one has to realize that this is a constitutional, independent, autonomous body meant to take care of themselves. They have to create their own revenues. They have their own taxes. The dues that were there from the government side have been cleared completely. In fact, in some cases, we have given 20, 30 crores in advance to district councils. So therefore, these kind of blame games should not be done, and we should work in a constructive manner to resolve these issues.